Check 1, 2. DUBTurbo 2.0 is here. Well, not really. It's a tease video. I'm on my last pass back with the programmer. Once I pass this back to him with the final few little bugs, it's coming. And it's, pause, it's being released. 2.0 is going to pop off, and we've overhauled it. Had a lot of complaints, feedback, good stuff, bad stuff, and we've tried to accommodate everybody with this update. I think we've done a great job. What started out 2 years ago as a little project internally has turned into quite the controversial, top-level broadcast quality beatmaker. And in the interim, I'm going to take a moment here while you guys absorb this visually. I love it, the way it's turned out. All three panels have been overhauled from top to bottom. I'm going to talk a little bit about the beatmaker itself and the project itself. A lot of the bigger producers in the world and a lot of the bigger software, I won't say the software, but the producers and the users out there, we get a lot of hate for the software. So let's talk about that for a second. Why do we get a lot of hate? We get called the Fisher Price beatmaker, or we get called the My First Beatmaker beatmaker. Why is that? We aren't the most sophisticated, biggest DAW, and we don't discriminate. I personally have a huge studio. In fact, here's a picture of what I'm sitting in right now. On top of having DUBTurbo, I produce big, and I do stuff for audio, video, TV, film, make straight-out beats for artists, for background music, for commercials. I score a little bit. I do video game treatments a little bit. I do sound kits every other day. So I'm always producing audio. And let me tell you guys, the bigger producers, that give us a lot of hate. Sure, it's not the huge DAW that you're used to. However, A, look at the price point. B, look at the huge gap there is for beginner to intermediate producers. Look at all the stuff a newbie has to get, from a powerful machine, to a DAW, to VSTs, to a MIDI controller, to MIDI in and out wires, to earphones, to monitors, to audio monitors and then screen monitors, sound kits. Anyway, what I'm trying to get at is it's a lot of gear and it's a lot of commitment and it's a big learning curve. So this eliminates all that for one. And like I said, we don't discriminate. I love my Fruity Loops. I love my Cubase. I love my Logic Audio, or used to when I had my Mac. Love my Pro Tools when I played with it a few times. And it's all kind of the same. It's all sequencing at different levels. So this A acts as an amazing catapult into any of the other bigger DAWs once you get past the basics. And B, for the price point, the sequencer itself, aside even, the sound kits are up to 2,400, if not a few more, 25 maybe, 2,400 custom made. Over 95% of them are made right here in the studio. Samples, sound kits, voxes, effects, stereo imaging like crazy. We worked on these kits just mad. We worked on these kits probably the most out of this whole project has been the actual kit work. And then the revision process in the software has been a 2 year in the making, very expensive, very frustrating process. And we've capped technology. So my programmer is trying to, you know, constantly be on the bleeding edge of that technology. And we keep capping it and having to wait for technology to catch up. So the older machines, yeah, they'll still freeze here and there. If you don't have a good sound card, it might catch up on you here and there. But we're also constantly trying to work out things on this end on what technology does enable us to do so we can stay ahead. So for this project, this version of the project, we've accommodated a lot of things from performance to a lot of the bugs and few issues the users were having with the software itself. We've expanded it tremendously in the sound kit section, the audio engine capabilities. We can copy and paste bars vertically or in groups now, so you can extend your track and make it big really quick. Just a lot of stuff has happened in version 2.0, so we'll go over all those changes right now. I'm going to do what I usually do. This won't be an instructional video, mind you. It'll just be like I'm going to build another beat and show you guys what we've done in version 2.0 to improve on it. And what I'll do is build that beat. Here, let's start right now. I'll build that beat at a high BPM, so it's really working my machine. Let's say 180. You'll notice before, when I went in here and pressed any of the buttons, it would trigger the samples. So not a huge bug, but we managed to fix that, get that out of the way. We'll change our bar count. Actually, we won't even change the bar count just yet. Not much has changed as far as new buttons. Everything's just been laid out a little bit easier for the visual eye to navigate through, and all the shortcuts are labeled right underneath all the buttons. And a few other shortcuts are available within the help section. So what are we going to do first? We're going to draw two bars, click, hold, and drag. You'll notice now there's a nice white outline so you know which bar you're on. And we're going to click edit. You'll notice we have a new panel design for the drum machine as well. Turned out wicked as well. All the kits are now on the left-hand side, easy to get to. And again, tons have been added of everything, from instruments themselves, to voxes, to effects. Just went nuts on them. So I'm very, very proud of them. And I think you guys will really enjoy these, even if you pull them out of here and use them with other DAWs. And we'll do a few videos about that too, on how to import sounds into Cubase or how to bounce out tracks and import them into other DAWs to keep playing with them with a little bit more capabilities and effects and mastering and compression techniques and that kind of stuff. So, working at a tempo of 180, we'll start off with beatbox. Sure. A few things we'll take note of is the sound pads are here. And then as you're developing your beat in the sequencer, you have a reminder by actually clicking on any of these while they're highlighted. So if you're building a beat and you're like, what's number 5 again? You don't always have to go down here. You can just go 5. Oh yeah, that's my hi-hat and it's written. So it's very easy to navigate. The volumes, we used to have a little bit of a tricky problem where it wouldn't save the volume position. So if you changed kits, it would reset the volume. Even though the volume was at half, the kit would change, and then that would go back to here, even though we have it listed here. So a lot of the stuff with the volume, even the master volume and an exporting volume and whatnot, has been normalized, has been controlled now, so everything should stick nice and easy. So let's go ahead. I don't really want that one. Let's choose a different one. Okay, so just a nice and simple pattern I'll start off with. The loop, something else we finally fixed, timed right. No matter what tempo you're at, it'll loop pretty much perfectly for you guys now. That wasn't really a big issue for us, by the way, because this isn't a looper. Even though I know for beat making, it's silly not to have the loop working properly, but this isn't a simple looper. You grow the bar counts out, you start making your beat, you're not really worried about the first two bars or one bar looping properly or not. However, nonetheless, it'll finally loop properly. So even while it's doing its thing, we can keep developing and building on it now while it's playing. All right, so now you'll notice the volume here. That'll now stick, even if we change up. In fact, that's another thing we fixed, is while you're changing up the kits, it won't stop. It'll keep looping on the new kit now. Okay, the only thing is it'll loop once it's done its current loop, and then on the next loop around, that's when the new selected kit kicks in. All right, that's about it for this. The metronome is simple, on and off here. It's pretty much universal. Changing the tempo is done anywhere you want in the app. It's universal too. Nothing else is changing the buttons. Something else we've done here in the actual grid is you can't draw more than one sound on top of itself. We used to have a problem where you could draw unlimited amounts of kicks over themselves, and they would double, triple, quadruple in volume too, so it would throw your whole beat off and you weren't sure where or why there's a certain kick or a snare or a hi-hat going blowing your speakers and you're not sure why, because there's 18 little hi-hats in there somehow you didn't realize you have a bunch of them. All right, anyway, so that's fixed too. We'll get out of here. Something else I've really wanted my programmer to do is to let you guys copy these bars vertically. So typically I'd have to go in here, draw another bar, go in there and start building my beat again to match that one or to complement it or to contrast it, whatever I want. Now I can simply copy downwards. So now I have that same pattern on layer 2 and on a crunk. So now I have a beatbox and a crunk doing the exact same pattern, just with different kits overlapping. We'll see how it sounds. Not bad. We'll mute them. This is by itself. This is with both. That second one's really overpowering it, so we'll bring the volume down. I'm just gonna let it play, and I'll build out the beat quickly and show you guys what else we can do with this once we grow out the bar count.
What?
All right, so we have a vox layer. We'll keep going here. One more drum layer. Doesn't have to be a drum layer per se. And even though it says house or jungle or any of these kits, you apply them to whatever you want. You guys get as creative as you can. These are just naming conventions and grouping. But for the most part, it's just creativity holding you back from coming out with the most explosive, wicked, newest, hottest, freshest, most unique beat that'll have people going crazy. Effects. Some of these I haven't even really tried to explore with too much during beat process making. So I'll just be random here. Kind of like that. It's not bad either. And we'll turn it down a bit. Okay, so we have four simple layers, all drum. Now we'll move into the keyboard. Click, hold, drag. Notice how that white border sits around it. I'm gonna choose the arrow here. Watch this. I can now select all of the bars at the same time. So now when I grow my bar count, I can copy all those over, and I'll show you how to do that in a moment. But first, let's go make some bass. Oh yeah, all the keyboard triggers still work. For those of you new to DubTurbo, we utilize the keyboard to type on to enable you to actually pump out the sounds and samples like. That's me hitting the keyboard, being random with the melody, but you can preview all the sounds by just selecting a sound and then. Oh, I like that. Let's use that. I know that what's the mata gets annoying, but don't worry. That's only going to be there once in a while. But for now, I'm just structuring all the layers. Okay, we got a bass. Let's throw in some horns or trumpets or something nice and deep. And then contrast it with something nice and bright and light. Nice. And if we want to change it up, just change it up. You want to do chords? Excuse me. Sure. Pop them in. If you know what you're doing with chords, if you don't, we have chord charts for you in the members area. So you can go look them up. So you can do. Might not be able to tell on certain sounds, and you can on others quite a bit, and chording doesn't work because the sound's just too affected already, so it doesn't sound good overlapping too much. Sounds pretty good on this one. So we'll go back to the first one. I really like that horn. Not that one. That's the one. But we got to get rid of the chords now. See what I was saying? It doesn't always sound proper.